Here we are, coming to you live from the Top Secret Broadcasting Bunker here at Area 52. Pastor Mike here, and I'm online, and I am live. The guy sends me an email just now wanting to know if he can get his big semi-truck here in Area 52. If you can make it past the security guards and the drones that we have flying around with missiles attached to them, if you can get them past all that, yeah, just come on by. Bring it on down. I've got more bugs in my computer system than I think that there are bugs in the world, and I'm still trying to tweak and adjust the settings of Wirecast and get the recording to look like I want, and so on and so on and so on and so on. And so I'm still praying, living by faith, hoping that everything goes okay today with the recording and so on. So you pray along with me and I'll pray. And it is good to have everybody here. It's good to have everybody listening. You're listening live on KBTR FM Watchman Radio, Watchman FM in Samburu, Kenya. We are glad to have you all with us. We had about, I think about 160 people standing out in the rain last Sunday morning. It's Sunday night for them to watch the live service from Bethel Church. And it just overwhelms me sometimes when I get sent the pictures of the people standing there, the little children there, pastors there, one of them trying to interpret what I'm saying and so on. And that, it's, if you prayed for anybody during our live Sunday morning service, pray for the interpreter over there. He has a difficult job keeping up with me. Normally when I go to Kenya, I speak a sentence, the interpreter gives a sentence, I speak another one. But here's this man who is trying to interpret my words as they're coming out of my mouth. We forget sometimes that in America we have sayings and phrases that we use that we all know what they mean. And I'm sure to somebody in Kenya or somebody in Mexico or wherever it is would go, what did he just say? It's kind of like the phrase, ¿qué pasa? In Spanish. And it's our version of it be, hey, how's it going? Or, hey, what's going on? Or, hey, how y'all doing? And in Spanish, it literally translates to, what passes? Well, here in America, you ask me what passes, I'll tell you that I haven't been to the bathroom yet. Don't know. Just telling you. So anyway, pray for the interpreter out there and pray for the people out there that God will bless them. God would use this ministry. God would encourage pastors out there. I don't do this very often, but I want to strongly encourage you, if you have not seen last Sunday morning's sermon, I want to encourage you to go watch it. We have it now available on Sermon Audio. By the way, you get the Sermon Audio app. You get the Sermon Audio Bethel app, the official Bethel app that works on Android and iOS, which is Apple. You can get it from the App Store in Apple. You can get it from Google Play. Just type in Bethel Church. You might want to do a search for Festus, Missouri. And be sure and get ours and not the anti-Bethel Church of Bill Johnson, Redding, California. I got a little thing about him here in a little bit. But you can download the app. If you have not seen last Sunday morning sermon, I want to encourage you to do so. I have it posted on my YouTube account. It's called The Power of the Cross. And God used that sermon mightily for me and my life. And, you know, a lot of times when I preach, I don't often see the result of what God is doing. And one of the reasons why is years ago, I just stopped trying to preach a sermon and then trying to get the immediate results by having an altar call at the end of the service. I know that's how it's always done. And ever since I started going to church, you preach a message, have an altar call, preach a message, have an altar call. And I kept beating myself up every Sunday morning when I would preach a message and then I would give an altar call wanting people to come down, and no one did. And it frustrates a pastor. He thinks that the people are just bullheaded. He thinks they're stubborn. He thinks they're not responding to God's word. He thinks that he failed somehow in the message. And I was gauging how I was doing by whether or not I got instantaneous, immediate results. Then God reminded me one day, Mike, you are not a salesman. Now, that doesn't mean I haven't tried to be a salesman. I tried to sell Kirby vacuum cleaners at one time. That was a long time ago. I've drawn Amway circles before. I tried to sell pots and pans right after I got out of college, before I married Lisa. And as soon as they say, no, we can't afford that, I pack everything up and say, okay, see you guys. Thank you for your time. I'm sorry I bothered you. That's me. I just don't make the sale. And God reminded me, Mike, you're not a salesman. That's not why you're there. Why do you think that you have to have or see instantaneous results as evidence of my power? God is always right. When God is faithful to us and God is long-suffering with us, I have learned and am learning to be long-suffering and patient with God as well. And wait on the Lord. Wait on the Lord. Wait on the Lord. You know, we ought to do a Bible study one day on waiting on the Lord. Because a lot of things that I have heard in churchianity over the years, things like, well, God is waiting for you to take the first step. God is waiting for you to do this. God is waiting for you to do that. And I find no such scripture in the Bible anywhere that backs that up. What I find is when we pray and we ask God to do some things, sometimes God does give us a quick answer. Sometimes it works out that way. But I have found that when I pray and I don't get an instantaneous hit from God, I have learned to wait on him and trust him, and don't try to intervene for God on God's behalf, or don't try to produce results for God because it won't last. You can get people to an altar. You can pull some emotional strings in them and make them feel guilty enough to come down to an altar and pray and have a big show there. But it won't last. If it's man-generated, it will not last. If God does it, then he does it forever. I have a perfect example of that happening in our church with somebody who attends here. And I'm not really at liberty to share the details of it, but there was somebody here that I had been praying about. God, do this. God, do this. God, do this with them. And being patient with this person, and then all of a sudden, I see God doing it, and I'm going, that wasn't me. That was not me that made that change in that person's life. That was God. And so anyway, the sermon I preached Sunday morning was about the power of the cross. And I'm telling you, there is nothing in our lives, nothing. Doesn't matter if we tend to relegate the cross to only, we tend to limit it only to the sins that we have committed. But the cross represents much, much more than that. It represents God's willingness to give us life and that we might have it more abundantly, and God's willingness to work in our lives, in our homes, our families, our marriages, our relationships, our work, the things that we deal with from a day-to-day basis, even our finances, healing diseases, healing emotional scars that people have. The cross, that's what it does. And I just went line upon line through the scriptures to show you. When we miss out on knowing what God said, How can I say this? I'll preach it better Sunday morning than I'm doing it now. But Jesus talked about you do err not knowing the scripture nor the power of God. And when we fail to bring things to the cross of Jesus Christ, we will make mistakes. We will err. We will do errors. We will think the wrong things. We will do the wrong things. It's just a sample of it. And I'm not trying to generate hits on YouTube. Doesn't matter to me how many people watch it. But if you're listening to me and you need a dose of something from God, I encourage you, go watch that sermon. And I hope it is a blessing to you. It was to me. And I am all about what God does through me and through our church, and really not about what I am doing. Because I'm telling you, there's no way in the world that I could just open up my heart and show you everything that God has done in there. But I'm telling you, I am the result of the cross of Jesus Christ and the mercy of Almighty God. That's why I'm here. Nothing more than that. I assure you, nothing more than that. You know what? Let me do this. I've got several things here. I wasn't sure what to talk about today, which is, you know, not good. If you're going to have a talk show, hell hates. If you sit there and don't say anything for 2 hours, then hell will start liking you again. Hell will start liking you at all. I have an email from a 12-year-old young man. And this is actually the second time I've seen this email. He sent it to me, I think, twice. Forwarded it to me again. That's what I think. I'm not sure if that's accurate or not, but that's what I think. I've seen it twice. He starts up by saying, "Do you have a free version of the Pure Bible software on Android that I can put on my phone?" And everybody, let's see if I have a graphic for that. Oh, well, looky here. There you go. King James Pure Bible Search software at purebiblesearch.com. And on that webpage, there is a link to the mobile device version of the Pure Bible Search software. Now, this is not an app. This will not install a program on your computer, on your tablet or your phone, whether it's iOS, an iPhone, or an Android phone of some kind, Samsung or whatever. This will not install anything on your phone. But what it is a simplified version on the web, on the internet, of our Pure Bible Search software that's designed to fit your screen. And I pulled it up on my desktop here, and it fills up the whole browser. But it's scalable in that if you're looking at your phone, which is probably about that big, if you're looking at your phone, it'll scale to that, and it's easy to push the buttons on there. You can do the search. You can get the accurate counts. You can count the Word of God. You can do lots of things with it, and the link to that is on purebiblesearch.com. So that's the first question that he asked me, all right? So then second question, I'm going to deal with this because I get stirred up. I do. I get stirred up when people lie about God, when they lie about the gospel, when they lie about the work of Jesus Christ. I get moved by it. And let's see here. So far, so good on the recording and the streaming. If there's any problems, those of you who know my cell number, let me open it up here so I can see if something comes in. Make sure everything's working A-OK. But I will tell you that there are times I've got a little readout up here on my screen that tells me how much of the CPU is being taken by what's going on here at Wirecast. Right now, I'm at about 76% of my computer's resources. Every now and then, I'll see a 95% up there. So just pray that it'll work, all right? Anyway, here's the question. Remember, this young man's 12 years old, and I like that. I like the fact that young men, young ladies are listening, and here's a young man 12 years old, that rather than spending all of his time reading Harry Potter books and playing occult video games, and he may do that, I don't know, but he's asking about the gospel. He says, I have a question. He said, you know the Ten Commandments? Yeah, I do. A person told me that to enter heaven, you absolutely have to obey the Ten Commandments. Now, this young man says, he says, this doesn't mean that I'm searching for a reason to sin. I believe you. But is it true? I'm confused a little. But I think that in the KJV Bible, it says that we are judged by grace, true faith. Now, I'm going to say, he says, by the way, I'm a new believer, so I don't understand all. I'm just looking for a verse or a chapter that can tell me. And he put a little smiley face there. This young man, I'm judging by, there's an accent in his spelling. Okay, there's an accent, believe it or not, in the way he spelled words on this email. He is either Dutch or he's German, all right? I'm going to say probably Dutch because we have several followers in Dutch land, which is Holland, which is the Netherlands. But anyway, he's asking. Somebody told him that you have to keep the Ten Commandments in order to go to heaven. You have to keep them. Here's where I'm going to start out first, all right? And I'm going to go ahead and say Jonathan is his name, because I'll probably mess up and say it anyway. But here's your answer. The first thing is, if there was a requirement that you have to obey the Ten Commandments, Jonathan, the bad news is it's too late for you. You have already broken at least one of them, at least one of them. And you're 12 years old. You may have yet to discover how to break the rest of them, but it's coming. It's coming down the road, all right? You've already broke them. You have already disobeyed the law. And I don't care if you're living in Germany or the Netherlands or the United States of America. If you commit a crime and a court is petitioned by, let's say, a prosecutor or the police department, they saw you commit a crime, or they have evidence that you committed a crime, a judge will issue an arrest warrant. It is a piece of paper that says, go put this guy in handcuffs. We're going to try him for his crime. There is an arrest warrant out for those who commit crimes. And in many cases, in American law, there is what's called a statute of limitations. And it says that after so many years, if you haven't arrested and charged this guy and had a trial within, I don't know, some cases, a year, 5 years, 10 years, whatever, then it's forget about it. We're not going to do it. But with murder and other crimes, serious, heinous crimes, there is no statute of limitations. And so it doesn't matter if you committed murder 20 years ago, 30 years ago, 30 minutes ago, you are still to be held accountable to breaking the law. It doesn't just go away. And in God's law, God's legal system that he gave at Mount Sinai, the idea was that if you broke those commandments, you are worthy of death. The death penalty, therefore, applies to you. And it's not going to go away over time just because you forgot about it. So, Jonathan, the bad news is you've already violated at least one of the Ten Commandments, maybe more. So if it were the case now that you had to obey the Ten Commandments, if that was the case, there is no reason for us to be asking God to save us because we have already broken the law. If salvation comes by way of the Ten Commandments. It doesn't. Let me tell you what the Ten Commandments does. And I have a beautiful illustration of this. All right? Let me tell you what the Ten Commandments are good for. Let's see here. Where can we go? We're going to go to the book of Genesis. There is a beautiful, beautiful typology here. And I'm just kind of, here's one of those American euphemisms here. I'm flying by the seat of my pants. I don't know where that came from, but basically it means, we're going to go to Genesis chapter 24. I don't know where it came from, but what it means is I'm making this up as I go. Okay, so Genesis 24, and Abraham sent his servant, I can't remember his name, but Abraham had a servant, and at one point Abraham was going to consider giving his servant his inheritance, and God said, no, that's not what I want. You're going to have a child, Abraham. You're going to have a son. It's going to come out of your bowels. It's going to come out of Sarah. And I promise you that your seed, your offspring, is going to bless every nation in the world. And of course, that was Jesus Christ. But it's Eliezer is his servant. Abraham takes Eliezer and he says, I want you to go into the land of our heritage, land of our forefathers. I want you to place your hand inside my thigh, and I want you to swear to me that you're going to do what I ask you to do. I want you to go to our family and find a bride for my son. Now, I want you to get the picture of this. Here is Abraham. Playing the part of God is Abraham. Abraham is the father. Abraham has a son, his only son, Isaac. We find that out in Genesis 22. We also know that Abraham offered Isaac, his only son, as a willing sacrifice, and God provided a substitute. I love that. So he sends Eliezer out. Playing the part of God is Abraham. Playing the part of Jesus Christ is Isaac. Playing the part, I think, of the Holy Spirit is Eliezer. Eliezer is going to go and bring a bride to the son. I like this. Okay. I want you to, let's see here. Where can we find this? Let's see here. There is a place, it mentions in verse 61 that Rebekah arose and her damsels and they rode upon the camels. Okay. It says somewhere back in here, you're going to have to help me find it. That let's see here. I got to find this verse because it's absolutely essential. Here we go. Let's see here. The damsel is going to verse 55. Let's see. That's not what I'm looking for. I'm looking for the exact number of camels that they leave with. And there is a place in here where it specifically says that it was 10. I'll probably have to look it up. Anyway, instead of me wasting time here, let me just tell you a story. Eliezer goes to the house of Laban and finds Rebekah, and Rebekah is going to be presented to Isaac as his bride. Okay? Rebekah comes, and her damsels, they come riding in on camels. What it doesn't tell you in that verse, but it tells you in another place in this chapter that the exact number of those camels was 10. So I want you to think about that. What is it that brought you to Christ? It was the Ten Commandments. The law. The law is what brought you to the foot of the cross because you were under the condemnation of that law. You were under God's judgment. The wrath of Almighty God was going to be poured out upon you, and you had no other choice but to plead for mercy because of the Ten Commandments, represented in this story by the ten camels, all right? And so here is Rebekah being brought to Rebekah, the bride, the church, you and I, being brought to the son, Isaac, Jesus Christ, by the 10 camels. You and I were brought to Christ by the law. You understand that? We broke the law. We had to come for mercy, and that's what we did. That is the purpose of the law. Paul talks about that in Romans chapter 5. He talks about it in numerous other places, that God went from one law in the Garden of Eden to a bunch of laws in the book of Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and so on, because he wanted to magnify sin. Why? So that it would magnify his son, Jesus Christ, and his work on the cross. So if there's someone out there who has, in fact, broken all 10 of God's laws, which I would say it's probably easy. I would say that if you live a normal life here on this earth, chances are you have broken the 10 commandments, all of them. There's a pretty good chance that you have. I don't know of anyone who has never dishonored their father and their mother. I don't know of anyone who has never lied. I don't know of anyone who has never taken something that didn't belong to them. Maybe it was when they were 8, 9, 10 years old. It doesn't matter. I don't know of anyone who's never looked at another one, any man who's never looked at another woman and said, "Hey, baby," or vice versa. I don't know of anyone who has never lusted or coveted after something that their neighbor has. That person does not exist. So the fact is, number one, you've already broken the law. Now, here's what we're going to do. Let's go to various places in the New Testament to find what really the Bible does say about whether or not we have to keep the law. Now, as I present this, I want you to understand something. I do not believe the law is bad. I do not believe that the Ten Commandments are something that we don't have to pay attention to anymore. A lot of people will use this phrase, "We're not under the law," as an excuse to go do whatever the stink they want to do and think that they won't face any consequences for it. Let me tell you something. If you are a child of the living God, and God treats you like you are his son, which we have a clear teaching of that in the Bible, when you sin, and sin is the transgression of the law, when you sin, not if you sin, as a child of God, but when you sin, God is going to deal with you as if you were his son. Now, here's something I know about both being a child and a father. I did not spank or use a belt or my wife's wooden spoon, which she handles very ninja-like. Okay, that's her. I did not use the rod of correction on my children every single time they did anything wrong. I didn't do that. That's not wise as a parent to do that. Okay? And I know there's probably some parents out there that think that every little thing their child does deserves a whipping. And I don't believe that. I don't think the Bible teaches that. I know for a fact that not everything that I do wrong, God just absolutely wails on me. I don't believe that. As a father, I tried to have, even as a young man, and wisdom doesn't come easy for young men, but I tried to use a little bit of judgment and wisdom and mercy with my children, that if I saw them do something wrong or they disobeyed something I said, even if it was something small or big, I would say, "Now listen to me. That's enough of that nonsense. Clean this room up, or do these dishes, or do this, or do that, or don't do that. And if not, I will be dealing with you again." And there's no doubt in my mind, God gives us warnings. God gives us a little bit of rope, a little bit of leash, and he'll pull on the leash every now and then. But if we are insistent that we're going to go after something that we should not be a part of, God will deal with us as he does with sons. In Hebrews chapter 12, the Bible says in verse 6, "For whom the Lord loveth, he chasteneth and scourgeth every son whom he receiveth." Which basically is, there is an implication here in Hebrews 12. Now, that's not the limit of what I believe. concerning sin in a Christian's life. But it is part of it. There is an implication here that if you are a child of the living God, there, God will chasten you because of your sin. Remember what he promised David. Let's see here. Genesis 24:10. I think it is the verse about the 10 camels. Thank you, whoever you are. Okay. For sending that in. Genesis chapter 24, verse 10 talks about the 10 camels, I believe. But anyway, back to this. God doesn't chasten you if you don't do anything wrong. I mean, Hebrews 12 is not saying, well, you're a son and you don't sin anymore, but God's still going to whoop the fire out of you every now and then just because he wants to. That's not what God does. There is an implication in Hebrews 12 that if we sin, God will chasten us, and he tells us to not refuse that. He said, if you endure chastening, verse 7, God dealeth with you as with sons. And he tells David concerning his son that was going to come out of his bowels, which was Solomon. He told David, Solomon's going to build a house for me. You can't. You got blood on your hands. Think of Christ. When he comes the first time, he's got blood on his hands, literally. And he cannot build the temple of God. He cannot build the house of God at his first coming. That's who David represents. But God said, the son that comes out of your bowels, out of your own body, that proceedeth forth from you, he is going to build a house unto me. The typical of that is Solomon. The antitype of that is Jesus Christ, who builds his own house. I do not believe that the Jews are going to build a temple in Jerusalem for Jesus to dwell in. I do not believe that. Now, they might build a temple. They might have a building made with hands in Jerusalem. But I promise you, Jesus is not going to live in it. There's going to be another one that will. Think about that. That's a... You follow me? He's going to build his own house. But anyway, here's what he told. And I've been sitting in this room now for the past 4 hours and haven't touched my nose one time. And now it itches like crazy. Here's what I'm telling you. God said, your son is going to build a house for me. And I promise you, I will be his father. He will be my son. God was adopting David's child. He'll be my son, David. I'll take good care of him. And here's what I promise you, David. I promise you that I will never take my mercy away from him. I will never do that. And if he sin, if he transgress, if he breaks my law, I'll chasten him with this rod of men. I will beat him until he can't stand up. But I will never take my mercy away from him. And I've preached a series about that, and there's still a part of that idea and that understanding that I have not preached yet. I'm waiting on the Lord. I'm waiting to say, I think I found what that chastening was. Okay. I think I found it, and it's hard. It's hard. It's going to be hard to talk about. All right. But anyway, God promised he would never take his mercy away from Solomon, and he never did. Solomon did everything that every one of us guys wish we could do. He had everything we wish we could have. He had it all. He sinned in numerous times, even built temples for his wives, for their gods, and offered incense in them. Shouldn't have done that, Solomon. But God never took his mercy away from him. And I know for a fact that Solomon is in heaven right now, because Peter said, holy men of God spake as they were moved by the Holy Ghost. And we know Solomon wrote at least part of the book of Proverbs. We know that he wrote the Song of Songs, or the Song of Solomon. We know he wrote Ecclesiastes. He is a holy man of God speaking. He is a holy man of God writing down what God said. But here's what God did with Solomon's sins, his transgression of the law. He chastened him. So he says, If you endure chastening, God dealeth you as with sons, for what son is he whom the Father chasteneth not? But if you be without chastisement, whereof all are partakers, then are you bastards and not sons. Whereof all are part, are not, well, let me read this again. But if you be without chastisement, whereof all are partakers, then are ye bastards and not sons. And let me tell you something. Let me tell you, Jonathan, and everybody else in the world that's listening to me. There isn't a church member, there is not a deacon, there is not a Sunday school teacher or a board member or a pastor anywhere in this world that is exempt from God chastening them. Not one. What that means is, he says all are partakers. What that means is that even your pastor transgresses God's law. Now, he don't like anybody to see it. He doesn't want anybody to know about it. But he does. I guarantee you he does. There is no, even as wicked and vile as the Roman Catholic Church is with their confessionals and all that stuff, there are priests assigned to hear the confession of other Roman Catholic priests. Even they believe that one. And I'm not exalting them in any way, shape, or form. But I'm telling you that your Sunday school teacher, your church board, your church deacons, the song leader, the youth pastor, the pastor, and all of the people in that congregation, if they are truly born again, then they are partakers of the chastening of Almighty God because they transgress the law. Still to this day, they do it. I read the doctrinal statement a year ago of a hyper dispensational church, and these hyper people made it clear in their church doctrinal statement that only the 14 epistles of the Apostle Paul were valid for them. The rest of the Bible had nothing to do with them. Therefore, they do not A, water baptize, and B, they are not chastened. They do not let God chasten them for their sins. Wrong answer. Because, and if they're sincere on this, they are bastards and not sons. It's as simple as that. I couldn't believe this when I was reading it. I'm going, are you kidding me? Are you telling me? Are you talking to me? Are you talking to me? Are you trying to tell me that you don't let God chastise you and spank you? No, that's not for us. Well, it says right here, all are partakers, right? So anyway, furthermore, we have, verse 9, furthermore, we have had fathers of our flesh which corrected us, and we gave them reverence. Shall we? By the way, the same people who believe that they do not receive chastening from God are the same people who say you don't have to repent of anything, not even to get saved. You don't have to repent of anything after you get saved. And I'll tell you something, the people who believe that you don't have to repent usually don't. They don't, and they're not going to. See what happens when you just don't believe the Bible anymore? But anyway, we have had fathers of our flesh which corrected us, and we gave them reverence. Shall we not much rather be in subjection unto the Father of spirits and live? Subjection to the Father of spirits. Did you see that? For they verily for a few days chastened us after their own pleasure. But he, meaning God, for our profit, that we might be partakers of his holiness. And when he uses the phrase his holiness, he's not referring to the Pope either. God chastens us to make us holy. That's the blessing of the Christian life, is that we have a desire to be holy. We just don't have much of the ability to be holy. So God deals with us the same way our fathers and our mothers dealt with us. Really? You won't do what I said? Fine. I'm going to take your belt. I'm going to whip you until you don't want supper anymore. That's what I'm going to do. And that's what my mom did. My mom never soft-handed me when I was little. She chastened me, left stripes on my backside. They were good stripes. I love her for it. I respect her for it. She taught me how not to go to hell. So anyway, now he says in verse 11, now no chastening for the present seemeth to be joyous but grievous. Nevertheless, afterward it yieldeth the peaceable fruit of righteousness unto them which are exercised thereby. So number one, if you are a son of God, a child of God, if you sin, it is understood by both God and us that they're in the process of you living out your life on this earth after you've come to the knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ, that you will not do everything right after that. You will lust after things. You will lie. You will want somebody to be dead because you hate them. You will do these things that God said not to do. You will take the name of the Lord in vain. You will do it. If not in word, in thought. Can I talk about that for a minute? Do we not, as believers, even though we may not say the words, do we not think them? Should I tell you that I do? And I assure you, I do not, both here and outside of the scope of this camera microphone, I do not go around laying about curses everywhere. Nobody around here hears me taking the Lord's name in vain out of anger. I'm a doggone it kind of guy. Okay? But I think it. I know all the words. I even know how to spell them correctly. I don't know when that's ever going to go away. So a man telling you, Jonathan, that he's going to heaven because he keeps the Ten Commandments, that one about thou shalt not bear false witness, he's full of that one. He really is. So number one, if you are a child of the living God, it is understood that yes, you will violate God's law after your knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ and his salvation, your belief in it, and it is by God's grace that he chastens you. It is by his love and his mercy that he does so. He is trying to make you more holy. He's trying to help you along with the wickedness of your flesh. He's trying to get you to go, you know what? I didn't like the whipping I got then. I'm not going to go there again. And I can tell you, there are things that when God whipped me over them, it was so bad and it was so hard to endure that it has been a lifetime remembrance of who I was, what I did, how God dealt with it, and me saying to myself, I never, ever, ever want to have to go through that again, ever. I think I'll do what God wants. It's good. It's good. Now watch this. So that's how he deals with it. In Romans chapter 3, or let's Romans chapter 2. Let's do this, okay? We have Paul showing us, if you look in Romans chapter 1, you have a list of things here, 23 things. If you were to go through that list, being filled with all unrighteousness, fornication, wickedness, covetousness, maliciousness, I could just stop right here, and that pretty much covers most everybody that I know, including me. Okay? We could just stop right here and say, okay, I get the point. You don't have to keep going. Well, I'm going to keep going. Unrighteousness, fornication, wickedness, covetousness, maliciousness, full of envy, murder, debate, deceit, malignity, whisperers, backbiters. Even my grandson, Liam, he is already on his road to hell. It was so funny. Liam came in my office yesterday morning, and there's a space between the couch I have in my office and a set of cabinets that I have. And Liam went and got down in that little crack there and sat down to hide from me. Uriah, my other grandson, came in, saw Liam in there, so he turned around and backed his way back in there and sat down in front of Liam. Like 5 seconds later, Uriah's come crawling out of there, and his face and his expression, he is about ready to scream bloody murder. You know what Liam did? Bit him in the back. I mean, he got him. Big old teeth marks right in the back. He was a backbiter, people. Backbiters, haters of God, despiteful, proud, boasters, inventors of evil things, disobedient to parents, without understanding, covenant breakers, without natural affection, implacable, unmerciful, who knowing the judgment of God, that they which commit such things are worthy of death. That'd be you. That would be you, wouldn't it? Okay. In Romans chapter 2, here's what he says. Verse 12, for as many as have sinned without the law shall also perish without law, and as many as have sinned in the law shall be judged by the law. Let's see here. Let's go to verse 19. And art confident that thou thyself art a guide of the blind, a light of them which are in darkness, an instructor of the foolishness, a teacher of babes, which has the form of the knowledge and of the truth in the law. Thou therefore which teachest another, teachest thou not thyself? And thou that preachest a man should not steal, dost thou steal? He says the word preach here. Well, that would be me. Would it be right for me to get up in front of everybody Sunday after Sunday, Wednesday night, Pastor Mike online, watch him broadcast, and just whip and thrash all of the sheep that are part of Bethel Church while I don't have to say anything about myself? That wouldn't be right. And I can tell you, there was a Mike Hoggard that did that. The Mike Hoggard that is now can't get away with it, because God will chastise me. You go listen to what I preached about the cross, the power of the cross, Sunday morning. It'll come out, I promise you. Okay? But here's the thing. If I preach against stealing and I steal, I'm a transgressor of the law just like everybody else does. Thou that sayest a man should not commit adultery, dost thou commit adultery? Thou that abhorrest idols, dost thou commit sacrilege? Thou that makest thy boast of the law through breaking the law, dishonorest thou God? For the name of God is blasphemed among the Gentiles through you, as it is written. For circumcision verily profiteth if thou keep the law, but if thou be a breaker of the law, thy circumcision is made uncircumcision. Therefore, if the uncircumcision keep the righteousness of the law, shall not his uncircumcision be counted for circumcision? And in verse 27, and shall not uncircumcision, which is by nature, that's the way us guys are born, if it fulfill the law, judge thee, who by the letter and circumcision does transgress the law? Let's get down to, let's see here. Verse 9 of chapter 3, what then? Are we better than they? No, and no wise. For we have before proved both Jews and Gentiles that they are all under sin. As it is written, there is none righteous, no, not one. Let's see here. Verse 20, here we go. Jonathan, here's a simple answer to your question. Romans 3:20. Now we know Romans 3:23, right? For the all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. So let's draw a circle around that. Paul said, walk circumspectly. I think that applies to a lot of areas in life, and I think it applies to reading and understanding the Bible. And when somebody like a pastor, like me, or somebody that you meet who says, oh, you got to keep the law, you got to keep the Ten Commandments to go to heaven. When someone tells you that, and someone addresses that to me, I'm always quick to say, what verse was that? What place is that where you just said that? What is that? They may or may not be able to tell me something, but I'm always apt to go look to see where they got that from and what is said both before and after that, not just maybe in that same verse or that same chapter, but what comes in the neighborhood of what's being talked about there, And does it contradict other places in the Bible? And I do not believe that any one thing in this Bible contradicts any other thing in this Bible. The scripture cannot be broken just because you have a doctrinal statement. Just because you have a belief that only certain little corners of the Bible are for you and the rest is for everybody else. Just because you don't like what it says doesn't mean that it contradicts itself. It cannot. Scripture cannot be broken. Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, forever. God said, I am God, I am the Lord, I change not. He's consistent in how he deals with people. And so he says here in Romans, look at the neighborhood that it's in. Romans 3:20. Therefore, by the deeds of the law, there shall no flesh be justified in his sight, for by the law is the knowledge of sin. A Sunday morning, I used a picture as an example of a speed limit sign. And I've seen this many times. Be a speed limit sign, and then right underneath it, there's a little digital readout that the local sheriff's department, the police department, whatever, they'll put there with a little radar gun. And as you're approaching that sign, your speed is being displayed on that digital readout sign. So the speed limit says 25. The radar says you're doing 40. Now, if there was no sign that showed you the speed limit and the digital readout said you're doing 40, you'd say, wow, it seems like I'm going a lot slower than what I am. Maybe I'll speed it up a little bit. You have no idea what the law is. Only what you are doing. But they put that speed limit sign up, 25 miles an hour, and you're doing 40. Does the speed limit sign keep you from breaking the law? No. All it does is give you knowledge of the law. Now, I asked this question Sunday here at Bethel, up on the top of the hill here from our church is American Legion Drive. It used to be the old Highway 61-67 intersection there. And if you get on this road, there's concrete on American Legion Drive that is at least, I would say it probably at least has to be 50, 60, 70, maybe 80 years old. Okay, still there. It's the old highway. And up on top of the hill, there is an American Legion Hall, hence American Legion Drive. There is a daycare center there. A lot of traffic coming in and out of there, school buses, parents dropping children off, and children who, despite everybody's best efforts, could run out of the door of that daycare and run down into the street. Now, the speed limit there along that stretch is 30 miles an hour. I drive that stretch of road twice a day, usually 5 to 6 times a week every week. I've been doing that since 1994. And before that, we did it, you know, Sunday morning, Sunday night, Wednesday night when I was growing up. The speed limit's been 30 miles an hour on that road. What do I think about that speed limit? Is it good? Yeah, I think it is. Number one, I think it's a response. There is a lot of wide open space on that road so that if a child was running down the driveway there to the street, you would have lots of time to see it. And 30 miles an hour gives you a reasonable speed in which you could stop your car in a very short distance. In other words, I don't say to myself, well, I'm not under the law anymore, so I can drive however fast I want to drive. If I decided to drive down American Legion Drive 70 miles an hour, like I have the ability to on Highway 55, I can drive 70 on Interstate 55, Interstate 44, 70 miles an hour. When you get to Oklahoma, it goes up to 75, and we go, whee, here we go. But is it a good idea to drive 70 miles an hour in front of this daycare center? No. So when I look at that speed limit sign being 30 miles an hour, and I find myself driving 30 miles an hour because I know the speed limit and I know where the cop is going to sit when he's doing radar checks of that road, I consent that that law is good. And I am keeping that law. Not because I'm under the penalty of the law and I'm going to go to hell if I don't. I'm keeping that law because it's a good law. What is it that's keeping us after we have looked at another woman or another man? What is it that's keeping us from just going to their house or a motel somewhere and committing adultery? The fact that we believe that God's law against adultery is good. And it's not wise to break that law. Does that keep us? Does that keep us from lusting after a woman or a man? No. Does the speed limit sign keep us from breaking the speed limit, the speed barrier? No, it does not. I can tell you what does is when we receive the chastening of that law, the consequences of that law. I've told this before. I can drive faster than the speed limit on most streets. Okay, I know how to do it. And one day I did in Hillsboro. And I thought the speed limit in this area on this road was 50 miles an hour. I honestly did. And when I come zooming down this road, I'm doing 55. I'm trying to get my girls to a dentist appointment. I had just performed the funeral ceremony of our 12-year-old neighbor girl. She lived right next to us. Her dad bought her a four-wheeler for her birthday. She got on it on her birthday with no helmet, drove a half a mile down the road, and killed herself running into a tree. And I preached that funeral, the hardest thing I've ever done. No, about the third hardest thing I've ever done. And I just wasn't thinking. I got pulled over. Cop said, "Did you know the speed limit here is 35? Oh, no. He gave me the ticket. I tried to call to pay the ticket. They said, this one, you went too fast. You have to come to court for this one. Oh, good grief. And after that, after going through all of that, I realized that I just wasn't in that kind of hurry anymore. And I'm more apt to keep the speed limit than I am to break it. I'm not saying I always drive the speed limit, because I don't. But I remember the consequences of it. So here's what he's saying here. Romans 3, "Therefore by the deeds of the law there shall no flesh be justified in his sight, for by the law is the knowledge of sin." The law, the Ten Commandments, is just the speed limit signs telling us what we cannot do. "But now the righteousness of God," verse 21, "without the law is manifested." Listen, folks, there can be nothing in your Bible that violates that verse. Nothing. "The righteousness of God without the law is manifested, being witnessed by the law and the prophets." Did you see that? Did you, to all the people out there who have been taught from the pulpit that now they in the Old Testament, they were saved by keeping the law. That's not what it says. It says that even the law and the prophets foretold of the righteousness of God without keeping the law. Abraham. God justified Abraham before there was a law. God had given Abraham his righteousness for nothing than just believing what God said. And Abraham believed God, and it was imputed in him for righteousness. Boom, that's it. And you and I are of the seed of Abraham when we have received the righteousness of God by way of believing and trusting what God said, faith. So Jonathan, this guy that tells you you got to keep the Ten Commandments in order to go to heaven, I'm telling you that there is not one thing in the Bible that contradicts Romans 3:21, not one. So you have to keep it in that context. That is the unchangeable, immovable, unbreakable, everlasting covenant of God, that he accepts sinners and gives them righteousness on the basis of faith. not keeping the law. So verse 22, even the righteousness of God, which is by faith of Jesus Christ unto all and upon all them that believe, for there is no difference. If a Jew believes, he can be saved. If a Gentile believes, he can be saved. Doesn't matter who they are. Anybody at any time, anywhere in the world, past, present, or future, saved by grace through faith. Jesus Christ and his death and his resurrection is what provided the means and the method by which we could be absolved from our sins, those sins being transferred to Christ on the cross. And some would try to make an argument that says, well, how could they be saved before Christ? He hadn't died on the cross yet. And yet here the Bible describes Jesus as the Lamb slain from the foundation of the world. When God has an eternal, everlasting gospel, it's not limited from point A onward. It's always. There has never been two gospels. There's never been two ways of righteousness. There's never been two ways to have eternal life. Never. Never, ever, ever, never. It's always been the same. For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God, being justified freely. Freely. What's it cost? Nothing. Nada, nil, zilch, the big goose egg, the big O. Being justified freely by his grace through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus, whom God hath set forth to be a propitiation through faith in his blood, to declare his righteousness for the remission of sins that are past through the forbearance of God, to declare, I say at this time, his righteousness, that he might be just and the justifier of him which believeth in Jesus. Now some of you are going to say, aha! Said they had to believe in Jesus. When Abraham died, he went to a place in the lower parts of the earth. We find in the book of Luke, chapter 16, that that place now is has been referred to as Abraham's bosom. When Lazarus died, he went immediately to the lower parts of the earth in Abraham's bosom. All of those, according to Hebrews 11, who died in faith. Isn't it interesting? Isn't it interesting that Hebrews 11, that great faith hall of fame, we call it, and all those people like Noah and Enoch and Moses and Abraham and Sarah and Isaac and Joseph and Elijah and Rahab the harlot and all of these famous people who had faith. In Hebrews 11, isn't it interesting that all of them lived in the days of the Old Testament? There is not one New Testament person mentioned in Hebrews chapter 11. If I'm thinking correctly, there's not one New Testament post-crucifixion, post-resurrection believer. Not one. They're all from the Old Testament. And the writer of the Hebrews 11 specifically said these all died in faith. In faith. They believed in whom they had not seen. But it says they believed in Jesus, right? When Jesus died, we know that his body went into Joseph of Arimathea's. That's what I used to think it was. Joseph of Arimathea, went into Joseph's tomb and laid there for 3 days. Body never saw corruption, no stink, no worms on him, nothing. His soul went to the lower parts of the earth. He said that that's exactly what he was going to do. As Jonas was in the whale's belly 3 days and three nights, so shall the Son of Man be in the heart of the earth. We know that he went down there. We know from two different places, I think Peter wrote both of them, that he went down there to preach to spirits in prison. He went to preach the gospel. So even though Abraham had not physically one-on-one with his eyes met Jesus, we know that he met Jesus, maybe for the first time, while he was in the lower part of the earth. I think that the Lord, Jehovah, who spoke to Abraham and gave him those promises, I believe that that was probably none other than Jesus. I absolutely believe that the angel of the Lord, the man that Jacob wrestled with, was none other than Jesus. So to say that these men could not have received the gospel of grace through faith because they didn't know about Jesus, I don't think that's necessarily true. Who was it that Moses saw in the burning bush? Go look at that one. It starts out saying that the angel of the Lord called unto him from the burning bush. And then when we see the voice in the burning bush, he says, I am the Lord, capital L-O-R-D. That's Christ in that bush, okay? It was Christ who walked down the road with those two angels. Those two guys went on to Sodom, and here is Christ talking to Abraham and Sarah, telling them, you can laugh if you want to, and I know you're going to lie about it, but I'm telling you, come this time next year, you're going to be holding your baby from your body in your arms. Did they believe Jesus? He was standing right there. Anyway, what else? Romans 7 is a good place to go. Where it says, verse 5, Romans 7, 5, for when we were in the flesh, the motions of sins, which were by the law, did work in our members to bring forth fruit unto death. That's exactly what's going on with me right as we speak. My body is producing enough corruption, but stink up half of Texas. By the way, you Texas people, I'm awfully proud of y'all. Let's see here, where's the story? Texas defunds Planned Parenthood clinics. Let's see here. Texas on Monday barred Planned Parenthood from receiving state Medicaid money, the latest setback for the woman's health care provider since it became embroiled in controversy over undercover videos about its handling of fetal tissue. Hours earlier in neighboring Louisiana, a federal judge blocked the state's efforts to cut the group's funding. In a letter to Planned Parenthood clinics statewide, Texas health officials said all funding from Medicaid, the government health care program for the poor, was being cut because of what it characterized as program violations captured on the videos. It was the videos that did it. It was the proof of these evil murderers eating salad, drinking wine at lunch, talking about selling babies' brains. Nonchalantly, like it's no big deal. Oh, yeah, we're making a killing all this. Now, we can't tell everybody that we're doing that, but oh, my goodness, you should see the money come rolling in. And so the Texas government said, well, if you're making so much money on that, then you don't need state Medicaid money. And they defunded them. That's going to end up in court, I guarantee you. But y'all did the right thing down there. Kudos to Texas. Anyway, I generate quite a bit of corruption, okay? I do. You don't want to be around when it happens either, all right? There we go. Back to Romans chapter 7, for when we were in the flesh, the motions of sins, which were by the law, did work in our members to bring forth fruit unto death. But now we are delivered from the law. See that? What does that mean? What does it mean we're delivered from the law? We're no longer under the condemnation of the law. The death penalty has been lifted. We are free. Again, two things to keep in mind. Does that mean that we can sin all we want to? Nope. Try it. Okay? Try it. Go ahead. say, well, I'm saved. Saved. I'm going to heaven no matter what. No matter what I do, I'm saved. If you really are, try that. Go out and do whatever your filthy little body wants to get involved in. Because if you really are saved, God's going to beat you so hard, your kids are going to be dizzy. That's a... If you're not saved, you'll think you got away with it, and the preacher told you, oh, you don't have to repent now that you're saved. You don't repent now that you're saved. You don't have to repent. Don't repent. If you're not saved, you'll think that you can do everything you want to do and get away with it. And the reason why God is not going to chastise you is you're not his son. I think there's a lot of church people who say they believe the Bible that do whatever they feel like doing because they were told that it doesn't matter what they do. They don't have to repent. They don't have to be sorry for anything, and God's not going to chasten them. Don't worry about it. It's not what the Bible says, people. It's not in here. So he says, but now we are delivered from the law. So again, can you sin all you want to? If you try it and you are a son, God's going to whip you and you'll wish you never had. You'd be like me standing there crying in front of my mom. But mom, I'm sorry. And mom was saying, yeah, you're going to be. You're fixing to be. She didn't buy that for a minute. And then number two, if you really are saved, you think the speed limit signs are a good idea. You think that the law against lying and stealing and commit adultery and lusting after your neighbor's house or your neighbor's wife or his servants or his bass boat or whatever he's got, you think that's a good law. And it's what's in your heart. It's how you're raising your family. It's how you work every day. You know, if I knew I had somebody that wanted to work for me, and I knew that they believed that they could do anything wrong and not have to repent to God for it, I would not hire them. I would not hire them. I had somebody that worked here that I think had that in mind. They don't work here anymore. If I knew that you believed that you could do things wrong and not have to repent for them, there's no way in the world I'd hire you here, because you would think you could do whatever you want to here. And what I'm telling you is that even the laws at your work you think are a good idea. Like showing up on time. Like not stealing company money or company paper clips or company tools. I used to paint houses. Not using company paint on my private jobs on the side. See, I know how it works. I think those laws are good. I think they're a good idea, because if all the employees started stealing from the boss all the time, where's my raise going to come from? We do think the law is still good. So anyway, now we are delivered from the law, that being dead wherein we were held, that we should serve in newness of spirit and not in the oldness of the letter. I do these things because I want to do them, not because I have to. I spend 2 hours a day with you all Tuesdays and Thursdays, not because I have to, not because I'm paying for my sins. I'm doing it because I want to do it. You're listening to me because you want to listen to me. What shall we say then? Is the law sin? God forbid. Nay, I had not known sin but by the law, for I had not known lust except the law had said, thou shalt not covet. And you're going, oh, that's what that is. Well, whoops for me. So anyway, that's Romans chapter 7. Let's go to Galatians, all right? Galatians spells it out very plainly because, Jonathan, the people or the person that told you that you had to keep the Ten Commandments in order to go to heaven, Paul wrote a whole book in the Bible just for that person, just for them. It's called Galatians. Paul said, number one, verse 6 of Galatians 1, I marvel that you are so soon removed from him that called you into the grace of Christ unto another gospel. Jonathan, what this guy told you was a different gospel. It was completely different. And then he says it's not really a gospel. He said in verse 7, which is not another. In other words, there isn't another gospel. There is no such thing as good tidings of great joy to all people that if you keep the law, you can go to heaven. If you told me that while I was in my sins, I would say, well, that kind of stinks. According to you, I'm already going to hell. And if the requirement is that I keep the law and don't break it, I've already done that. So thanks for your time. Thanks for the tract you just gave me, but I'm not interested. It's not another gospel. Whenever you or your doctrinal statement says that other people are saved by keeping the law in different dispensations, I'm going to say this nicely. That's a lie. It's not true. When you say to me there is more than one gospel, I will say back to you, though we or an angel from heaven preach any other gospel unto you than that which we have preached unto you, let him be accursed. That's what I'll say back to you. Any other gospel. Let me show you something. Look at that verse then, again, Genesis chapter 1, verse 8. But though we or an angel from heaven preach any other gospel than that which we have preached unto you, let him be accursed. Now, we all know that a guy who goes by the name of Joe Smith, don't know why I didn't want to use his real name here, but a guy by the name of Joe Smith from, what was that place in Illinois? Anyway, he gets visited by a moronic angel. No, wait a minute. It was the angel Moroni. That's who it was. An angel Moroni, appears to Joe Smith and says, I have another testament of Jesus Christ. It's another contract. It's hidden in a hillside in, what is it, Qumrah? Something like that. It's hidden here. I'll show you where it is. Dig it up. It'll be golden plates with something called Reformed hieroglyphics. You'll need these special glasses called the Urim and the Thummim. And when you put these special glasses on, you will be able to translate correctly the Book of Mormon. And once you do, I want you to give it to everybody you can because it's the new contract. We all know that. We all know that Joe Smith received another gospel from an angel. Joe is cursed. Brigham is cursed. All their 14 wives are cursed. All the people who follow their religion are cursed. And whatever angel, Moroni, that was, that angel is cursed. We know that. Here's something I happened upon here a few weeks ago in doing a study in Revelation chapter 14. Because I'm told by hyper people that there is the gospel that Paul preached. There is a different gospel that Peter preached. And during the quote-unquote tribulation time in Revelation, there is an angel who preaches a different gospel than the one Paul preached in Revelation chapter 14. I'll show you, let's see here. In Revelation 14:6, I saw another angel fly in the midst of heaven, having the everlasting gospel to preach unto them that dwell on the earth and to every nation, kindred, tongue, and people, saying with a loud voice, fear God and give glory to him, for the hour of his judgment is come. And I am told by the hyper people, by the different gospel people, that that is a different gospel than the one Paul preached. If that is the case, Paul made this terminology here in Galatians chapter 1, verse 8, is there's no ambiguity to it. There's no mystery behind it. There's no veil that surrounds it to where you don't understand what it means. But though we are an angel from heaven, here's an angel in heaven. I saw another angel fly in the midst of heaven. Though we are an angel from heaven, preach any other gospel unto you than that which we have preached unto you, let him be accursed. Paul is telling us if this angel preaches a different gospel, he's a hell's angel. He is a cursed angel. Don't believe it. And listen, I love God's people. I love you for standing up for the word of God. But my goodness, people, think about what you're saying. When you say that, the four gospels in the Bible, they're not for us. That's a different gospel. That's the one you have to endure in order to be saved. We don't have to do anything to be saved. We don't even have to repent to be saved. That's our gospel. Then in the tribulation, they're going to have a gospel where they have to do works, and it's preached by this angel. Think about what you're saying. That if that's true, this angel in Revelation 14 is going to hell. Going to be cast in the lake of fire, and anybody who believes that angel is going to be cast in the lake of fire too. I'll give you another illustration of this. Go to Genesis 22. I want to keep my place here in Galatians. Go to Genesis 22. We know that Genesis 22 was a typology. It was a type. It was a foreshadowing of the cross, of the sacrificial death of Jesus Christ. I've used this illustration to show you a flaw in the New International Version Bible, a serious flaw in the NIV, and maybe others, I haven't checked all the others. But in the NIV, I know for a fact there's an error in their doctrine that they're teaching you. Genesis 22, he says in verse 2 of Genesis 22, and he said, take now thy son, thine only son Isaac, whom thou lovest, and get thee into the land of Moriah, and sacrifice him there. Doesn't say that, does it? It says offer. Offer him. And that's even legal terminology. The idea of an offer is one of the foundations of contract law. If you say to someone who needs, let's say they need money and you've got extra money and you don't mind helping them, if you say to them, here, take this money, you need it, and they take it and they go pay their bills or they go waste it at McDonald's, you're going to go and Judge Judy and you're going to sue them because you gave them $2,500 and they haven't paid you back, and you've been calling them every week and they haven't paid you back, and they say, you didn't say anything about paying us back. There was no, and Judge Judy's going to listen to, any judge is going to listen, where's the contract? If you said to them, here's $2,500, I'll let you pay me $50 a month until it's paid off. That's a con, and that's the offer. They don't have to accept it. They don't. It's the offer. Now, if they accept it, there's a contract. There was an offer and an acceptance. That's why on most, practically all contracts, if they're a written contract, both you and the contractor or the contractee or whatever, you both sign the document. You're signifying that you offered it to someone. They're signing, signifying that they accepted the offer. The idea of an offer is a legal term. It means exactly what it says. It does not mean that it's been fulfilled. It means it was offered. And God did not tell Abraham to sacrifice his son. He did not tell him to kill him. And I'll show you how important this is here in a minute. He told him to offer him. That is precisely what Abraham did, to the letter. He offered him there for a burnt offering. And so they make their way to Mount Moriah. And let's see here. And they came to the place, verse 9. And they came to the place which God had told him of. And Abraham built an altar there and laid the wood in order and bound Isaac his son and laid him on the altar upon the wood. And Abraham stretched forth his hand and took the knife to slay his son. And look at verse 11. And the angel of the Lord called unto him out of heaven and said, Abraham, Abraham. And he said, Here am I. And he said, Lay not thine hand upon the lad, neither do thou anything unto him. For now I know that thou fearest God, seeing thou hast not withheld thy son, thine only son, from me. Now, I'm going to show you what's here. In verse 1, Genesis 22, and it came to pass after these things that God did tempt Abraham. God is the one who told him what to do with Isaac. Now over here in verse 11 and 12, we have an angel of the Lord who, when Abraham is ready to plunge the knife into Abraham's chest, the angel says, don't do that. What did Abraham do? If God told him to sacrifice, kill his son, which is what Abraham understood, because the Bible says that Abraham believed that even if his son died, God was going to raise him back from the dead. Well, there's a foreshadow there. Isn't it cool? Abraham had heard God say, offer him. Abraham thought he was going to have to kill him. The angel then comes and says, don't kill him. If that angel contradicted what God said, Abraham, with tears in his eyes, has to look at that angel and say, that is not what God told me to do. But of course, we know from the King James that God never told him to sacrifice. He told him to offer him there. And then an angel comes and tries to tell him something different, but it's not really different. You get my point here. The angel would have been lying, and Abraham would have said to the angel, I don't know who you are, but I have to do what God said. And it's the simple thing there in Revelation 14 as well. If that is a different gospel, then that gospel and that angel is cursed. Back to Galatians. So he says, let's go to chapter 3 of Galatians. He says, O foolish Galatians, verse 1, who hath bewitched you, that ye should not obey the truth, before whose eyes Jesus Christ hath been evidently set forth, crucified among you? This only would I learn of you, received ye the Spirit by the works of the law or by the hearing of faith? Which was it? When you receive, and boy, I get into Pentecostal doctrine too. Pentecostal doctrine, a lot of Assembly of God, other Pentecostal churches, United Pentecostal churches, the charismatic churches. They all have a belief that you can be saved but not have the Holy Ghost. Wrong. If you do not have the Spirit of God's Son abiding in you, you are not saved. Period. If you do not have the indwelling Word of God, Spirit of God, the Holy Ghost, if you do not have that living and abiding in you, you are not going to heaven. But they say you get it later. How much later? Well, we're not sure. Well, when does it come? Well, if you do this, then it will come. And I'll give you an example. I know a guy. He was the friend that tried to encourage me to get into the King James, and I wouldn't do it. I wouldn't listen to him. But he told me, he said, Mike, my story of coming to the Lord was I was invited to a United Pentecostal church. United Pentecostal, they're out there. They don't believe in the Godhead, the Father, the Son, the Holy Ghost. They don't believe that. They don't believe they're separate yet one. They believe that there is only one part, period. And that it was God the Father, and then it was God the Son. Now it is God the Holy Spirit. They don't believe 1 John 5:7. They'll be the ones who'll tell you, we only use the King James, except, of course, 1 John 5:7. That was added in there by the Catholic Church. We don't believe it. But anyway, he said that he God had brought him under conviction, and he went forward to the altar, and he asked, the pastor came down, he asked God to save him. So with tears in his eyes, he gave his life to the Lord. This man is a Jew, okay? I've known him since high school. He's a Jew, real one, okay? And I have a lot of fun with him on that. But he came to the Lord Jesus Christ in that church, and tears in his eyes, accepted God's plan of salvation for him. He believed the Lord Jesus Christ, and he was saved. Right then and there, as soon as that's done, everybody in the United Pentecostal Church is saying, well, there's still more to it. I mean, he doesn't even have the Holy Ghost. So here's what they teach. They got him up. They said, we're going to get you filled with the Holy Ghost. Okay. And they said, now, raise your hands up like this, which there's no verses that say that, okay? Raise your hands up like this. So he raised his hand. All right, now, say hallelujah. So he's going, hallelujah. Again, no verses that say that. All right, now do it again. Hallelujah. Do it again. Hallelujah. Faster. Hallelujah. 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 And he went, woo, he's got it. The guy's beating the drums and they're playing the guitar. And he's, oh, he's got the Holy Ghost. Did you hear him speak in tongues? Hallelujah, bless God, he got it. And they called it priming the pump. That's what they called it. They said, he's got to get full of the Holy Ghost and speak in tongues as evidence of salvation. If he don't do that, well, then he ain't saved. That's what we believe. Well, and they believed that he had to perform a work and a ritual and some kind of stupid priming the pump thing, which there's no verse in the Bible that says that, in order to be baptized in the Holy Ghost and to really be saved, more saved than anybody else is. Because he evidenced it by speaking in tongues. And that was a lie. Paul specifically said, foolish Galatians, who hath bewitched you? This only would I learn of you. Received ye the Spirit by the works of the law or by the hearing of faith? Which was it? Did you have to get up and prime the pump in front of everybody? Did you have to get up and repeat a mantra over and over and over until your tongue almost fell out of your mouth? Or did you read the Word of God or hear the Word of God preached one day and God's Spirit entered into you and convicted you and brought you to repentance? Is that how it happened? And Paul says it's a hypothetical question. And the ultimate answer is, it was by the hearing of faith. Faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. And then he says, verse 3, are you so foolish, having begun in the Spirit, are you now made perfect by the flesh? Because there is a doctrine that says, and it's a false one, but it's a doctrine that says that once you are saved, the flesh then must be pure and not ever be defiled after that. And if it is defiled, then A, you probably aren't saved, or B, you were saved, and now that you've sinned, you've lost your salvation. But you must get it back by repenting. Because if you don't repent, this, and this is not just Mormon doctrine either, this is Finis Dake stuff. And there's some of you out there that knows why I keep bringing Finis Dake up every now and then. Finis Dake taught that if you were saved and you did not cleanse your flesh from all unrighteousness and iniquity, and you sinned again, then at that point you are in danger of hellfire. And if you repent, then God re-saves you. It is called repeated regeneration. And if you sin and it stays unrepented of, then God goes back and gets all of the other sins that you committed and puts them back on you. So it's as if you had never repented and never were saved. Now you're back to square one again. Folks, I can't even begin to describe how wicked and how pompous and arrogant Dake was and those that follow him. Because the ultimate, the end game of where Dake is going is that at some point you, as a Christian, become totally sin-free and never sin again, ever. Not one time. That's what some people believe. Let me read this again. Are you so foolish, having begun in the Spirit, are you now made perfect by the flesh? And so he said, verse 5, he therefore that ministereth to you the Spirit and worketh miracles among you, doeth he it by the works of the law or by the hearing of faith? Which is it? And the obvious answer is the hearing of faith. Do you believe what God said? Do you trust God? And he goes on and on in Galatians. I wrote Jonathan, you know, the short answer is you cannot keep the Ten Commandments. You have never kept the Ten Commandments. You're not going to keep the Ten Commandments. You cannot be saved by the Ten Commandments. There was a condition in the Old Covenant that if someone succeeded in keeping the law, that God would bless them in abundance. That was for all mankind. But the thing is, there was only one man who actually succeeded in that. It wasn't Moses. It was not Aaron. It was not Aaron the high priest. It was not any of the Levites. It was not David. It was not Solomon. It was not Isaiah. It was not anybody. It was the man Christ Jesus. He was tempted as we are, yet without sin. So he is the one who actually kept the commandments. The only one. And I'll tell you why. One of the reasons why is God sent forth his son, Jesus Christ, to keep the law. That gives him a place of honor above all mankind, because he was the perfect Son of God, the sinless Son of God. If you were also sinless as well, you could think yourself equal with Jesus Christ. And I'm telling you, there is no for anyone else who is worthy to receive the honor other than the Lord Jesus Christ. And God will not share his glory with you or anybody else. You might take it on yourself, because as I've said this over and over, and I will keep saying it, I have never met someone who believes that because of what they do, they receive blessings and merit from God. But what that person was so arrogant and cocky and haughty, they puffed themselves up, elevated themselves over everybody else, and they made you feel about that big because you didn't keep the law. Let me tell you the little secret. They didn't either. They didn't either. You do not, listen to me, you do not know someone who is better than you. You don't. You don't know anybody who is perfect without sin. Or let's say they may only sin once every 3 or 4 years. And even at that, it was just they dropped a penny handing the change over to the grocery store clerk and didn't realize it until they got home. You don't know anybody who is sin-free. You don't know anybody who is better than you. You don't know anybody who has no sin. You may know somebody who thinks they don't sin, or you may know somebody who pretends that they don't sin. But I'm telling you, I know their little secrets. They do. They just A, either lie to you about it, or B, and this is where it gets really dangerous, they lie to themselves. They take, I counseled a man one time years ago. He was in a Nazarene church. The Nazarene denomination as a whole has gotten so far away from the gospel and so far from the word of God. The Nazarene church right now amongst Protestant churches, non-Catholic churches, is probably one of the most occult, devil-manifested denominations in the country, because practically the entire denomination has gone in after the emerging church contemplative prayer stuff. I mean, it's in all of their colleges everywhere. The Nazarene denomination is a branch of Wesley's doctrine. Who is it? John and Charles Wesley? It's a branch of the Wesleyan groups, one of which is the United Methodists. You have the Nazarenes. You have there's a group called the Wesleyan Holiness people and so on. But he was a deacon or some kind of older leader in a Nazarene church. And from down in Texas somewhere, he ends up, heard me on Southwest Radio or something like that. Anyway, he was passing through for a while, and he stopped to visit with me to just kind of pray with him. And he told me a story. He said, my wife and I have been part of this church for years. We got married in this church. We've served in this church. We've raised our children in this church. And here we are serving the Lord in here. The pastor he's an elder man, and he's kind of getting on up there in years, but he's been there forever. And his son is
news from the graveyard.
He's not dead. There we go. All right, I think I got it now. But anyway, he comes to me and he's bawling his eyes out saying that the pastor's son has been having sort of an affair with his wife. In other words, every time this man would go to work, the pastor's son would come out for a visit, prayer meeting. And he said their claim was that even though they kissed and hugged and were touchy-feely all over the place, that they never actually, you know. So finally, the guy goes to the pastor and says, I hate to tell you this, but this has been going on between my wife and your son now for quite a while. My wife has confessed to it. And something needs to be done. Your son's got problems. So they had a little hearing at the church, a little meeting, and they determined that since, you know, no bada boom, bada bing, then it really wasn't wrong. It really wasn't adultery. And this idea that you can, once you're saved, you do not sin after that. I asked the man, I said, I know that's what Nazarenes believe. And I said, how do they think now about all this? And he said, well, here's what they do. He said, they either lie about whether or not they sin. They tell a lie saying we don't sin anymore. Or whatever they did, that's not a sin. And I'm going, how convenient. That's what I'm telling you. You don't know anybody who doesn't sin. You might know somebody who thinks they don't sin or tries to convince you they don't sin, but you don't know anybody who doesn't sin. You don't know a preacher who doesn't. No matter how high he elevates himself or no matter how high others elevate him. Billy Graham sinned. Pope Francis sins. Kenneth Copeland sins. John Hagee sins. Mike Hoggard sins. They may try to convince you that they don't. I'm telling you the secret of all preachers. We do. And the good guys will admit it. It's the guys that are in love with their own legacy. They want to be remembered as the holy man of God. Those who are kind of like that, they'll never admit it. And they'll always make you feel about this big when you're in their presence. And so will about half of that church, because they've all followed the pastor in maintaining this idea of we're holier than everybody else. And if you want to come into our church, we're going to ask you not to defile us because we don't do anything wrong. I had a guy that brought his family here to Bethel. The thing they had moved out here, started coming to this church. After about 8 months, I was kind of seeing some things, and I thought, Mike, some point you're going to have to deal with this. Well, God brought it about where he came to me one Sunday afternoon, just shaking his head. I said, what is wrong? He said, I'm having some problems. I said, what? He said, I cannot figure out how to reach people. And I'm listening to him. He said, I can't figure out how to reach the people in this church about what they're doing wrong. And I went, excuse me? Yeah, I don't know how to connect anybody in this church or reach them and show them the things that they're doing wrong. And I knew that was going on. There was a lot of other things going on too. But I looked at him and I said, let me tell you something. Number one, it's not your place. It's not. If it's anybody's place, it's mine. And I don't exercise that authority very often because I love my people and I'm patient with them. I know that they've got some issues and I've seen that patience pay off. I've seen God do great things with the people in this church over the 20 some odd years that I've been here. I've seen lots of good things coming out of people. That had I just put my foot down and tried to confront them about every little thing that I didn't like, they probably wouldn't be here. And I said, it's not your place to do that. but he felt it was. He felt that he was above everybody else and had a right to go around trying to pinpoint errors in people's lives. They shouldn't have this particular ringtone on their phone, or seen that on TV, or they shouldn't have been part of that. And he was going to make sure that they all knew how wrong and how evil that was. And then I called him in a barefaced lie. He was trying to work behind the scenes to get people to come out of his church, come out of this church and go to another one that he was going to help start. And when I confronted him about it, him and his wife left and they went to a church here in this town. The pastor and I are very good friends. And I didn't say anything. And about 6 months later, that pastor calls me and he says, "Yeah, do you know so-and-so?" And I said, "Yeah." He said, "What do you know about him?" And I told him, he said, "I'm here too. They're doing the same thing." And what I'm telling you is, people, those people who pretend that they're better than you, that they live better lives than you, and they don't have a television, and they don't do this, and they don't do that, I'm telling you, those people are not being truthful. They're being dishonest. You are going to deal with in this life either lust of the flesh or the lust of the eyes or the pride of life. That's what you're going to have to deal with. That's what the Romans said. That's what the salvation of Jesus Christ is all about. Dealing with any of the three groups of sin that you are going to be guilty of. Now, I will say this. I'm not saying that every man in the church reads Playboy and goes around jumping in all these women's beds all the time. What I am telling you is somebody may not struggle with lust of the eyes or lust of the flesh. I guarantee you they struggle with pride. I guarantee you. Nobody's righteous. No. Not one. Let's spend a few minutes here and see what's on your let's see here. I'm not going to read a name. Let me just read through this. Pastor Mike, when a young child, God helped me. Let me explain. I never finished school, and this English not all that well, so bear with me, all right? But anyway, I never finished school, and matter of fact, never even made it to the eighth grade, but ended up dropping out of high school. The reasons were not my own for even my own understanding, but God's only. At the age of five, I sat on a dock fishing all day and never left that spot until I hooked by faith. Not in my own self, but by the faith and believing I would. God started showing me at the age of five that it was not the hook that caught the fish, but how the faith in the hook with its barbs would hold them after hooked. What I'm saying is this: I am a simple man and am laid low as I should be to let his love within shine out for all those to see. And by doing so, the message would be, although this man is a simple man, he was able to hear my voice by closing out the loud noises he had with his outer ears, inner ears of his own heart to me, so he could not only hear me but rely on the words spoken to him through the Holy Spirit as a promise left behind to show the truth of God's way as spoken by his true Son that still lives today. Jesus Christ is my Lord. Jesus Christ came in the flesh to dwell among us as proof of his Father's existence. Jesus said, "No man can come to the Father but through me." Jesus also said this: "Wait for 3 days, and after 3 days I will appear to you." And let's see where he's going with this here. He has a question. Do you believe in Jesus Christ, the true Son of God, and the blood that holds true power as saving to all whom believe and accept what Jesus did for you on that day? Pastor Mike, I am only a simple man. God made me that way, so please reprove me if in fault. I don't see a whole lot here. Christ died for you, and in your faith and trust that God alone is your Savior, that's your salvation. Do you believe the record? That's how John put it. Do you believe the record that God gave us? Now, someone says, "Hey, Mike, if there's only people according to your beliefs, let me help you with that. it's not according to my belief. It's according to the scriptures. There is only one gospel. There is only one way. One. I'll keep reading. Hey, Mike, if there's only one gospel according to your beliefs, then why do you not ever mention the woman with the alabaster box like Jesus said to do when you spread the gospel then? 26:7, there came unto him a woman having an alabaster box, a very precious ointment, and poured it on his head as he sat at meat. But when his disciples saw it, they had indignation, saying, to what purpose is this waste? For this ointment might have been sold for much and given to the poor. When Jesus understood it, he said unto them, why trouble ye the woman? For she hath wrought a good work upon me. For ye have the poor all you, but me ye have not always. For in that she hath poured this ointment on my body, she did it for my burial. Verily I say unto you, wheresoever this gospel shall be preached in the whole world, there shall also this, that this woman hath done, be told for a memorial of her. Todd, I have absolutely no idea what you're talking about. I have no idea what you're saying here. Are you trying to say that because this woman did a work by putting ointment on Jesus' feet, that that is a gospel? And if it's preached, that if other people do, I have no idea what you're getting at. It's not what I believe, it's what it says. There is no exception to Galatians chapter 1. There is no dispensation where that is not true. There is no time or era of time from Genesis 1:1 to the end of the world where there is an alternate, conflicting gospel or way of inheriting eternal life. It doesn't exist. If it does, show me where it is defined. Show me where it is preached. Show me who said it. Show me the place where it says, this is the gospel of the salvation of works to the Jews, or this is the gospel of working to earn merits with God during the tribulation. Doesn't exist. And I'll be honest with you, it's going to get to the point where you can start calling me names, because that's what happens when I bring this subject up and people don't like it and they want to try to prove me wrong. Then I say, well, just give me the scriptures. Show me where there's a difference that saves people for all of eternity. And then they start calling me names. I'll be waiting to hear from you. I have no idea what you're talking about with this woman, and why do I not ever mention the woman in the alabaster box? How in the world do you know that I've never preached on that? I have. Anyway, it's good to be with you today. One gospel, by grace, through faith, that not of yourselves, it is a gift, not of works, lest any man should boast. And Todd, I don't think you get it. If that angel in Revelation 14 is preaching a different gospel than what Paul said, the scriptures cannot be broken. Paul was telling you, he's warning you then, that angel's a liar. I don't think you get that. I don't think you understand. In fact, you didn't even address that one. Anyway, God bless you. I love you. It's good to be with you today. Pray for us here always. I've had several people in our church tell me in the last few days, battle has been, there's devils all over working against people here in this church. I mean, it is. Guy called me just today, bawling his eyes out. Pastor, will you pray for me? I'm having a hard time. And I can tell you, it started Sunday morning. Okay? If you haven't listened to that message, The Power of the Cross, go listen to it. What I preached was dangerous to the work of the devil. It was very dangerous, and he don't like it. So you pray for us here, all right? God bless you. I love you. We'll see you later.